Hello, welcome to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and my guest today, Gary Palmer from the GMB. Gary, thanks for joining us and welcome to
The
Vote.
You're welcome, Frank. Thank you.
I feel like, I was going to say, the last time I asked you in, I asked you in to talk about something called Co-Performer, which is a company contracted to run the non-emergency ambulance service, a patient transport service across Sussex. And I was rather hoping when you next came in, there'd be other things to talk about, but actually they're still in the news, really, aren't they? I mean, we're recording this on a Monday morning. They promised to pay your members on Friday. That hasn't happened. Where are we with this?
Well, you're absolutely right. That hasn't happened, and this story seems to run on and on. The effect of that is we have a number of staff, around about 20, 25 staff, who still haven't been paid now for 8 weeks. This Friday we're due to this month's pay, and so all the other staff who did get some form of payment will, of course, be looking to be paid again. And at this moment in time, we can't absolutely guarantee that's going to happen. The reason for that is that Co-Performer, although they've promised to pay everybody, on Friday, unfortunately, changed their mind once again and have said now that they need to work with ACAS and not ourselves to make that happen. But luckily, the CCG have stepped in now and are going to provide the money themselves. We will then work with a payroll company that we've engaged to try and get the money out to them. And then, of course, the CCG will look to reclaim that money from the contract.
So the CCG, the Clinical Commissioning Group, or I mean, I think the journalistic shorthand I use when I write about them is our health chiefs. I mean, these are the people that say what services we need, whether it's in the hospital, in the community, ambulances, etc. And then they commission either bits of the NHS or the private sector to provide those services. Why can't they just pay them themselves? Why can't the CCG just pay the staff?
Well, that's down to the employment status, and they are still employees of Docklands Limited. And because of that, we can't actually directly pay them because you need to be in a direct employer.
So Docklands is a subcontractor working for Co-Performer who's providing the service that the CCG has asked them. And the CCG, I should say, is operating on behalf of all seven groups of health chiefs across Sussex. So they've sort of said, this is the service we want. Co-Performer, you provide it. Docklands are providing it under subcontract for Co-Performer. Have I got that right? Because it seems terribly complex.
Well, that was part of the procurement, that Co-Performer would be the major service provider, but they couldn't provide the services themselves directly, which means they need to subcontract that out. Docklands have done that to a variation of companies. Thames Ambulance is one, and that's running reasonably well. They're a professional organisation, and they're delivering the service. But they then engaged a company called Langford's in the east and the west. Well, 2 months into the contract, Langford's went to the wall and went into liquidation, and then they suddenly produced Docklands Medical Services Limited and said these are a gold standard company, and then 12 weeks later we find ourselves exactly back in the same position. They've now gone into liquidation, and again, so that staff now have found themselves twice in this contract already, potentially unemployed.
I mean, if it's not a silly question, who was running this service before Co-Performer?
The South East Coast Ambulance Service ran it before, and successfully. I mean, there was always going to be problems within a service. That's the sort of nature of the service it is. But certainly not to the extent that we've seen since it's gone into the private sector.
And so South East Coast Ambulance, or SECAM as they're sometimes known, that's the sort of NHS ambulance service that if you dial 999, they're the guys who'll take you to hospital.
That's right. And they did provide it, as I say, for the same contract price. But it was subsidised through their A&E work as well. And SECAM, when it came up to recommission it and rebidding, said we can't continue to do it for this level of funding.
We need a bit more.
Yes, they do.
And a Co-Performer managing to cope with that 12.9 million for the year?
I don't believe it. I think if you look at the figures that are stacking up and the fact that now most of the hospital trusts are actually discharging patients through their own private ambulance services, that means there's going to be a bill landing on Co-Performer's doorstep for that. If you start to add it up, I can't see this contracting surviving past about a 10-month mark before they hit the 12.9.
I mean, it's funny, you're not the first person who's expressed concerns about the actual cold, hard cash realities of how this is going to be kept to price and who's going to pay for it if it goes over, whether that means Co-Performer goes bust or the CCG has to put its hands in its pockets and come up with more money, or indeed whether the hospitals themselves have to just write off the money they've spent on taxis and ambulances. I mean, because some of these, you mentioned private ambulances, some of these are like basically phoning the local cab company and getting people who've got an appropriate cab to drive patients often quite, because the Royal Sussex, when they're discharged from there, they can go quite a long way home.
Yes, and it's not always the appropriate cab. The taxi service had been running the cover for weekends for renal and oncology patients.
Yeah.
Now, no disrespect to the taxi company, but if you've just come off of one of the ranks in the town and you're asked to go up and pick up an oncology patient, probably who's just had, or at their weakest after their treatment,
yes,
to then get in a taxi, be taken home, you're not actually sure, and not be aware, the driver's not going to be aware of the clinical needs of that patient, and not going to be aware.
So if you pass out, for example,
he would actually have to just stop and then dial 999. So, and then of course you go back to the ambulance service.
Whereas the non-emergency ambulance crews, these guys are in many respects people who have got medical training, at the very least first aid training, and they've obviously presumably plugged into the health service network, so they can know whether to call 999 or you know, if they've got a paramedic colleague nearby, if they're not capable of dealing with the situation themselves.
The ex-CCAM staff were trained to a very high standard, and at times did assist CCAM on the A&E side when there was a needed demand, and used to back up their A&E colleagues. So yes, their knowledge is way above any standard sort of first aid.
I mean, the other sort of thing that sometimes people say to me they worry about with cabs, and again, like you said, no disrespect to our local cab companies who've got their job to do, but when you've got the non-emergency ambulance service operating properly, you've got vehicles that are kept pretty clean. I mean, really clean. When you're dealing with renal patients who've just had dialysis, people who've had chemotherapy, you've got worries about infection and cross-infection, and therefore you've got to have a medical standard of cleanliness that you know, we don't expect from an average cab driving around Brighton and Hove.
No.
Or Worthing, Ada, whatever.
No, and I think the ambulance providers do have, when they go back to station, or should have when they go back to station, Docklands don't have that many stations, and when they go back, should be able to go through a clean down procedure, which makes them medically fit to go back out onto the next day, because they come in, the crews, they're cleaned, and then the crews change over and then go back out to complete longer shifts.
You were saying Docklands don't have many ambulance stations. What's happened there? Because I thought they had four ambulance stations.
Well, they did when they commissioned and started off 12 weeks ago, but since that, the first station in Polegate was repossessed through non-payment of rents, and the landlord kicked them out. So there's been about five or six ambulances running out of Asda car park in Eastbourne, which is totally unsuitable. But again, you have to take your hats off to the staff who not only have gone down and made the best of it, of course, but
so they're not being paid. They're operating out of a car park rather than an ambulance station. So that must raise questions about, again, their ability to keep these vehicles suitably clean for, you know, patients who are often at their most vulnerable.
Well, they're using by any means they can. If that means it's simply a clinical wait, then that's what they're having to do. But they're trying their best to get out and deliver the service for the people of Sussex.
I mean, one of the other things I was going to ask about, actually, because I don't know if you, perhaps you can tell me if this is true, that they not only have they not been paid since the start of August in more than a couple of dozen cases, but some of them are putting fuel in the ambulances out of their own pockets and covering the cost of the phones that they used to get the calls on the jobs, because those bills aren't being paid either by the companies that are legally obliged to provide this service, contracted to provide this service.
Well, you're correct. You're absolutely correct. The guys have been doing anything by any means to try and keep the service running. So there have been occasions when they've made a collection amongst themselves to put £10 or £20 worth of fuel in there just to get the ambulance out on the road. Otherwise, they're basically sat on base, unable to work. And of course, then, you know, it's that logistic. And if the ambulances aren't out on the road, the company will be claiming that they can't invoice co-performer for the work done, therefore they can't pay them. But if they're not giving them the tools and the equipment to go out and do so, which at this moment all the vehicles have been decommissioned, nobody can do it, they're not insured, the keys are all sat in one of the stations, or the only station left, in a pot, and unable to be used. So they're all just sat there. So everybody has to report to work and then hopefully wait for something to happen. But it doesn't. Day after day, they're just told to go back home.
I mean, it sounds like the service is completely dysfunctional. It probably explains, I guess, a little bit that there was a health and wellbeing board meeting last week. And I mean, I hope you don't mind me saying, but you were thrown out. What was that? There was a bit of a ruckus, I think it's fair to say.
Well, yeah, I would dispute that we were thrown out. We refused to leave, okay. I think is probably a more an apt description.
I'm sure I heard them asking you to go.
They certainly did. And I think we'd been to two demonstrations, and clearly, I think, despite the fact that they'd been out working and everything was about it at those two demonstrations, was very good natured.
Yes.
It is getting to the point where people are angry and desperately want to see a solution.
I mean, I think the row last week was actually because one of the drivers wanted to speak and to tell some of the decision makers or some of the people who influenced the decision makers about you know, a first-hand account of the problems that are happening.
Yeah, it was as simple as that. The CCGs had given an account of what was going on, and the ambulance driver simply wanted to respond to that, to actually bring it more to the side of understanding the failures that are going on and the effect that it's having upon the staff. That was refused, and I thought for 2 minutes, considering most of these at that time hadn't been paid for 8 weeks, I thought wasn't too far, too much to ask.
Yeah.
But we should have done it. But yes, we did. We occupied it for about an hour, and it wasn't planned. But sometimes you need to make your point.
Yeah, and just before we take a quick break, are you getting any sense that this situation is getting any closer to a resolution?
Well, if I refer to co-performing Docklands, I would have to say no. What I will say is the CCG are now working very closely with us, and we are trying very hard to seek a resolution. If we can get the appropriate legal permissions from the companies involved, then we do have the ability to get everybody paid this week and on time, for a change.
I mean, because very briefly, you've actually already made hardship payments, which are sort of ex gratia payments, no obligation to some of those staff. I mean, modest sums, but just to keep them, tide them over.
Yes, I think it got to the point where we actually really did have to make those sort of payments. And you're right, it was a £100 supermarket voucher, but that was the difference between those families being able to feed. Listen,
we'll come back to this in just a second, but don't go away. I've got a few other topics as well. Join us after these ads. Hello and welcome back to The Vote with me, Frank LeDuc, and Gary Palmer from the GMB Union. You're the regional organiser?
I am indeed, yes, for Sussex, Kent and parts of Surrey, yes.
Oh, that's a fair old territory, and you seem to be very occupied, as I think we were saying in the first half, with co-performer. I was going to change the subject, but there was one other thing I wanted to ask you, which was, can they not just take the contract back off co-performer and say, look, you're not doing the job properly, we're going to give it back to CCAM, to the NHS ambulance service we had before? Why can't they just do that?
Well, I believe they can, and I think I've never seen a company more in a position where they frustrate a contract and certainly brought it into disrepute. So we are saying that can be. And I think we're finding that the political support is now also swinging that way. If I can say Hugh Merriman, Caroline Ansell.
They're MPs in East Sussex.
They are. And Peter Kyle in Brighton have been very, very helpful and supportive. They've done a lot of work behind the scenes, areas that, as a trade unionist, I'm never going to be invited into those sort of circles. So the good work, and I think they've done.
You and me both, Gary, actually. Well, as a journalist, I find I'm not often invited into
those circles. And if I do, then I have to gate crash, and that's usually not the productive note. But they've been really supportive, and I thank them for that help, but I'm going to continue to ask them for that help till we get this solved.
I'm going to say, and again, you probably won't thank me for saying this, but that's the Labour MP for Hove, Peter Carlin, that's two Conservative MPs who are over in the east of the... I know we haven't got any other Labour MPs, so it's not a party political issue as such. This is about trying to get a basic service running properly.
It is, and I will say as well, Stephen Lloyd, the ex MP for Eastbourne,
who's been a Lib Dem.
Yeah. He is, equally. Yeah. So I think we have real cross-party agreement on this, this is an absolute mitigating disaster. No doubt about it at all. There couldn't be any worse.
If co-performer keep not performing, is there any likelihood that CCAM would get the job back? Because, I mean, I hear CCAM have got troubles of their own.
Yeah, CCAM, we're all expecting CCAM to be put into special measures, and they certainly do. I think the 111 fiascos and the defibrillator issues that have come have made it clear that there are real internal disputes and problems within the organisation. But there are they're not the only ambulance provider in the NHS. And just along in Surrey is the South Coast Ambulance Service. And they've just won a big PTS contract in Surrey.
South Central, is it?
South Central Ambulance Service. So that's not a huge step to come across the border from Surrey into Sussex and pick this up.
Basically extend their operation when they're already running at scale.
Yes, they are. And they are capable of doing that. And they are working in partnership with CCAM. That was a very much publicised partnership by the chief exec of CCAM. So all the points are there. The logistics could be worked through, but it just needs to be done, and it needs to be done now.
Well, let's hope that happens. I mean, with CCAM, I don't know whether there are other issues, but CCAM is expected to go into special measures. I think some people would say that's sort of the best kept secret not the best kept secret in the NHS. Our local hospital trust, BSUH, Brighton and Sussex University Hospitals, runs the Royal Sussex, the Royal Alex, the Eye Hospital. They are in special measures, and again, probably not a surprise to everybody when it happened. They'd had a sort of, if you like, a warning letter a few months earlier, which kind of, I guess for anyone who's in the health service circles, they kind of know what follows that, unless there's radical change. I mean, disappointed that they're in special measures?
Yes, and I'm disappointed that it's come to that. I'm not surprised, and that's what we spoke about earlier. We're never quite surprised when that happens. And in this case, I think Dr. Gillian Fairfood, who's the latest in a line of temporary chief executive of the trust, have got their hands full to try and turn this around. The sort of positive from being in a special measures is that it does allow you to bring in experts from successful trusts, and there are successful trusts out there. And of course, it also gives you access to extra funding. Now, again, I know that's been a real issue up at the trust.
Well, they've got to pay for a lot of taxes at the moment, I hear.
Well, yes, that's the thing, and we hope they're going to get their money back from Cobra Former. I don't hold hope for that, but we need to do something. And I think since Matthew Kershaw, the famous axeman up at the trust, sort of left and moved over to East Kent Hospital. We've had a succession, and Gillian Fairfield is no different from that. My problem is with Gillian Fairfield being involved is that just after she arrived, she had to publicly apologise for her own trust, the Pennine Acute Hospital Trust, for the failures that had gone up here. So I'm not actually sure it was the smartest appointment when, from a failing trust, we bring somebody into an already failing trust.
When we say we bring somebody in, I sometimes get the sense that we don't always get the choice about who we've got.
No,
locally. I mean, these trying to find out from the NHS who's making these decisions and where they're made is becoming increasingly difficult.
Well, I think NHS England make the decisions, but I think there's almost a wheel of chief execs which just they roll around the trust. They come in, they parachute them in. They as far as I'm concerned, they fail to deliver what they're going to promise when they arrive, and then they just step back onto the wheel, move on to another trust, and another one comes in. They're all pretty much the same.
I have to confess, it's not a job I want to do. It strikes me as one that occupies your waking moment until you go to sleep at night, and 7 days, you know, it's the Royal Sussex, what, 8,500, that trust, 8,500 staff, some very difficult colleagues to manage, I imagine, because you've got some...
And some major works going on at the moment with the rebuild. But again, it is a really important
job. It's not your job to offer tea and sympathy, is it?
No, it's not. And you're not going to get that from me in any way, shape or form.
The other thing, one of the things that Matthew Kershaw did, which I think you approved of, actually, was he brought the Sodexo contract back in-house, the contract for catering, cleaning, portering, that kind of stuff, housekeeping, I think they call it. That was a bit of a union campaign, because the staff there were again, they'd gone without pay at times. They'd gone without equipment. There were quite a few issues that were happening there. All sorted now?
No. Sodexo have left, and that was always to be applauded. Hopefully we'll never see the like of them in Brighton again. But no, the issues have gone. The housekeepers, the cleaning staff and the porters are still finding that they are severely understaffed. Equipment failures and lack of equipment is still number one issue for them. Although we're not having tremendous issues with the pay like we did with Sodexo, you're right, they didn't get paid over a Christmas period for six weeks. We're not having those sort of issues. There are big problems with the pay, and especially around things like the porters, where we recently... I've just won a claim for the hospital porters in the theatres to gain similar pay to the rest of the porters. They were excluded for some reason, and we've taken 8 months to get this sorted correctly. But
was it administrative oversight or something more? Accountants trying to sort of like, that's an easy win?
Well, you'd have to ask the trust, but I mean, I find it hard when you've got one group being paid on one banding and another group being paid on a banding.
It's for virtually the same work.
Exactly the same work. In fact, the people who are in the theatre porters probably have to do slightly more work and variation than the general porters going around the hospital, rest of the hospital. But we've sorted that now, and we've got talks this week. Only thing we have to do is when that should have be started from. So we've got a negotiation to do.
There's a phrase that comes to mind: the devil is in the detail. One of the other disputes that came up this year, again, I suppose meat and drink to a union, pay and conditions, was at the co-op nursery at Sussex University, which I'd always expected cooperatives to be quite nice, cuddly employers, and I kind of came away with this one thinking, they don't seem as nice as I would have expected, because the staff there were given a bit of a rough ride.
I must agree with you. That was my expectation. The university used to provide the nursery and childcare services up there, then decided to contract that out. Mid-Counties Cooperative came in.
Yeah.
And initially it was helped and subsidised by the university. But that was always going to be on a set period.
Yeah.
And we always had the feeling that when that come, we would be looking...
When the subsidy ended.
Absolutely, yeah. And the fact that there was going to be a need to show bottom line profits. And that's where this issue came about. Suddenly the mid-county say they actually, once the subsidy went, they were losing around about £8,000 a year. Didn't like the thought of that because some of the staff were on, who had chupied in originally from the trust, from the university, had higher banding pay.
I'm going to say chupied is they were transferred across with their employment's right protected, which is the law.
That's right. Yeah.
And I mean, again, that's a curious thing because the some of these employment rights come through European Union law. I'm sort of slightly off topic, but is there a danger when we leave the European Union? I almost want to say if we leave, because I keep sort of detecting that it's taking longer and longer to even actually press the button to start the talks. But if we leave the European Union, are we going to start losing these employment protections?
I think once that does happen, and I believe it will happen, I think you'll find employers lobbying the government very, very hard to repeal any acts that have been brought about by being part of the European Union. And of course, it's always the workers. It's the easiest target when you look at facilities and any sort of thing. It's come back to the workers. That's your easiest target. Change your terms and conditions.
If I had to say there was a theme this morning, it seems to, I'm saying this morning, that's when we're recording this. I know we go out mostly in the evenings. The contracting out, yeah, I mean, Co-Performer, I've tried to talk to them several times. They've only come back properly once and with a holding statement once. Sodexo, they're a successful contractor to other private companies in lots of things, and probably to public companies, public services in many areas. They didn't seem to do well here. And the Midshires Cooperative doing the nursery at Sussex University was somebody who came in and provided a bit of the service that the university presumably used to run itself. I mean, in itself, there shouldn't be a problem with contracting, should there? Is it just a case of then how people get territorial over which bits they do and for what money?
Well, yeah, and I think it's all these companies are profit-driven, and that's the thing. When this does, an NHS contracts go out, they always say it's not going to cost us anymore because we're not going to remove things. But of course, then you have private companies needing to make a profit at those bottom lines. Yeah. And the 12.9 for the patient transport service was one. Two companies needed to come in and make, well, now three need to make a profit out of that 12.9. Yeah. Now that comes off the bottom line in frontline services. So there's always going to be a poorer service once you start to privatise.
I think there is, I haven't got time for it today, there's a whole debate around how that should work in theory and how it sometimes seems to work in practice. But thank you very much for taking us through Co-Performer, CCAM, the local hospitals and Sussex University nurseries. I hope you'll come back and join us another time. Maybe not about Co-Performer though.
That would be nice.
Gary, thanks. Please join us again on the boat very soon. Goodbye.